low carb, because that will keep you awake for the afternoon. I have a few announcements. First, new t-shirts and prior year t-shirts, which I believe are half price, are available at registration. Remember that all Shmoocon makes no money off of any t-shirt you buy. It goes to charity, and you get to choose the charity. Get them so that Heidi doesn't have to store them in the garage for another year. Party tonight is 9 o'clock. It will be on the terrace level. Just look for the crowd and listen for the noise. There's a bunch of contests going on, and there's fun stuff to play, so make sure that you head down to the other end of the hallway and do some stuff. And that's my only announcement, so I have a little bit of swag to give away. I think this is probably like a extra large 3, so somebody big ticket. I don't know. So again, somebody my size.
Nice shirt.
Well done. All right. Moose for somebody. Anyone want... This is going to hurt. All right. Where was that Aaron throw?
Oh, no.
All right.
You've got to get it on, Sandy.
On your own head, be it. All right?
Nice arm.
push-ups. So it is my pleasure to introduce to you today Whitney and Aaron, who are two of our hacker attorneys. These are people who have spent a lot of time trying to teach us to speak policy, to understand this entire other world that we really need to be more familiar with. They're both at the FTC, and I don't know if you're as worried about this as I am, but we were just talking. I don't think it's very long that the OnStar on your car is going to get a message from the Wi-Fi on your smart fridge telling you to pick up bacon and cheese because you're out. And that information is going to go to some data broker who's going to sell it to your insurance company, who's going to raise your rates because bacon. Some of these problems we'll be able to handle with tech, but a lot of them are problems that need to be legislated. They're going to have to be handled with policy. So listen closely and follow advice, and let's get involved and help these people do the job they're trying to do to protect us. Please.
Thank you, Sandy.
Thanks, Sandy.
Hi, everyone. Thank you guys all so much for coming to our talk, Goodnight, Moon and the House of Horrors. So if you guys are unfamiliar with the children's book, they say hello to quaint things in the book that were not IoT devices. And we thought, oh, well, we'll kind of, you know, tell the story slightly differently. And in this, we are going to say hello to a bunch of IoT devices, whether or not we like them or not, and say goodnight to them by kind of talking about the regulations. So a little bit about us. I'm a hacker lawyer who works at the FTC. I'm an attorney in the San Francisco office. I also have my master's in computer science, so I'm particularly in love with tech issues.
And I'm a hacker lawyer. I'm a technologist at the FTC here in DC, and I also have a master's in information management that I did at the same time. And we're actually both part of the NSF Cyber Corps program. Are there any Cyber Corps students here? All right, sweet. So if, for those that don't know, Cyber Corps, the government will pay for your typically master's, now undergrad programs in something cybers, and then will the way you pay that back is by doing government service for the number of years that you were in school for. So I think it's a great program, and look for universities if you're interested in doing education that way.
So really quickly, we kind of wish we had this particular IoT device. It is just a button pusher to advance our slides, but I could not get one in time. But I wanted to just, you know, point that out, that there's even an IoT device that will press buttons for you.
So this is our key disclaimer. These are the views of us as individuals and do not represent the views of the Federal Trade Commission or any one commissioner. We will repeat this many times.
Many times over. But yeah, please keep that in mind that this is us speaking and not our agency. So in the great interconnected world, and in this image, it's just all of the different companies that make IoT devices. And in the great green room, there was lots and lots of connected stuff.
So you think about the traditional devices like a baby mobile, and that is now connected.
There's eye punch gloves, which are connected punching gloves, which I guess could be kind of useful. We have, you know, pet camera, a mobile for your child that's connected to the internet.
The classic digital camera or photo frames,
etc. So, and that stuff was hacked. The reality is that everyone in creating all of these devices, just decide, well, the new feature will be, we'll just connect it to the internet. You know, take this old thing and we'll just make it so you can control it with your phone. And this is basically, it's great because there's a low barrier to entry to create devices in IoT, and we want, you know, innovation. But the reality is that it's all, you know, gloves with internet, or a baby thing with internet, toy with internet, or with Bluetooth connectivity. And the reality is there isn't much innovation, at least in that direction, because, you know, all you can do is now just like control it with your phone.
Yep. So take dumb device, add internet.
And it sells. And so, actually, going back, there are a lot of things here that, you know, have created this ecosystem. We're not going to mention everything. It's impossible. As we were writing these slides, we just, like, had to cut stuff out because there's so much to talk about. But the reality is this stuff sells. I got my first IoT device when I was in my computer security class, and we were talking about Zigbee. And I was like, oh, shit, I really, really want IoT light bulbs. And that day, I went out and actually bought a bunch of Hue light bulbs, and I love them. They're great. So the reality is even when you know how terrible it can be, you still want the stuff.
But then there's this trade-off, convenience versus necessity. Do you need a connected water bottle? Maybe, maybe not. But maybe some other devices actually are useful. Our 9-month-old doesn't like thermometers, so maybe a connected pacifier that reads thermometer might be helpful sometimes.
And it reports this information back to your phone. So every 10 minutes or so, it will take your child's temperature and report that back to you. And if you have a sick child, I can see that being like a real positive where, you know, if you're nervous about your kid being sick, you have this. And the other thing in the picture was literally, it just tells you how much water you drank and puts it into your phone. I'm not sure why.
There's a lot of questions. Do these devices fail dumb? There are a lot of scenarios. Does it require a server connection to work? What happens when the company goes under or if it's part of a DDoS attack?
So in particular, this was in the news, last year, Nest bought a company and then decided to not support that device anymore. They just turned off the servers, which was essentially going to brick the device that people had purchased, including a lifetime purchase. And that's not great because you don't really think about appliances and products as being something that doesn't die when it stops working, but like somebody else is choosing for it to stop working. And the FTC actually wrote a closing letter on this, which is kind of just like our commentary, saying, they refunded customers and that it was resolved eventually. But the attack on Dyne created a really interesting IoT situation. Not only were, the IoT devices actually, causing the internet to go down, but the IoT devices were failing themselves because they didn't have a server connection. And no joke, somebody's thermostat was actually just continuing to heat up because it could not connect to the server. And so when we talk about failing dumb, we talk about, you know, how should the device act when something doesn't go the way it should? And the reality is, heating your house up is not the answer. So, you know, and it's going to depend on the device, right? It scares me that my oven, if it can't talk to the server, what, is it just going to turn on? Like,
and continue to heat?
And continue to heat? That's not good, because half of having a connected oven, I imagine, is like you left the house and you're like, oh, did I leave the oven on? And you can be like, oh, no, I didn't. But if you can't rely on that information, that can be really dangerous.
So, you know, some of the ways that these devices have proliferated is Bluetooth low energy. You know, it's a standardized protocol. It's more interoperable. You know, all types of operating systems on phones use it, so it makes it easier to sell, so it means more IoT devices. But the specification, security, privacy, we don't know. So these are things that help kind of create this cycle that we're dealing with now with so many IoT devices coming out constantly.
I work with a lot of people who are very intelligent, but are not familiar with the hacker community. And I explained to them kind of how we can see who in the office has a Fitbit just by installing, you know, a Bluetooth sniffing app on your phone, and they were just kind of like shocked. And in another one of the talks, they were was it on Friday? Or I guess it was at PrivacyCon. Oh, the FTC had PrivacyCon. It's usually the day before Shmoocon. I suggest you go next year. We talk about privacy security issues on a very technical level. So the person mentioned that BLE, you know, most consumers will change the name of their device to say, you know, Whitney Merrill's Fitbit or Whitney Merrill's X device. And that is constantly being, you know, beaconed out to the world, and now people can track me. And consumers aren't really aware that that is something that can happen. And some devices, you can't even change the name. So, you know, is BLE a good thing or a bad thing? And, you know, consumers necessarily aren't the ones who are able to make those choices. So we wonder, you know, why is this connected to the internet? And this, in particular, is a company that sells connected diapers that track... that track stuff that goes into the diaper. you can think that this could be really helpful because often the people wearing diapers are the ones who cannot communicate correctly about what's going on with them, either it be children or adults. And so, you know, there is a positivity to it, but, you know, who's regulating this? You know, like, how do we make sure that this information that's very private is controlled? So, we also have, you know, things like a smart vent. I actually think this is really great. My father goes around and opens and closes the vents in my house when I was a kid, make sure, like, airflow is proper. I imagine this would have saved him a lot of headaches if he could have just done it from his phone.
There's IoT wine. We think about from the consumer side, there's IoT wine. I'm not quite sure what that does. But, you know, there is also the enterprise side. There are other industries, like the agriculture industry, that are actually getting value from connected sensors. There is usefulness, but the reoccurring question is, what are the risks? Where's the regulation? Is there regulation? Do we need regulation? And why are we connecting some devices, like a pan?
Like, I don't know what this pan does, but apparently it's award-winning, and it's a game changer. I mean, I have a pan, and I'm, like, happy when it's nonstick. Like, so. And finally, I like to think of IoT devices now as, like, a butterfly effect. Somewhere in the world, someone turns on their sous vide, and a website goes down. You know, like Deviant and Bruce have mentioned that they sous vide things, and I'm thinking, like, I need to get one because everyone's talking about it. But I'm not sure if they have a Nomiku, but apparently it is a Bluetooth connected sous vide where you can just put a timer on your phone and tell it to turn on and off and set the temperature, which, you know, do we need that? Because you end up you have to put the meat in anyways. So like you have to be at the device. So, you know, do we need this? That's a great question.
And bad IoT security. So this is the list that Krebs posted of the 60 plus Mirai botnet hard-coded passwords. You know, think about these are hard-coded passwords that now give access to making all these devices that you may not need connected can now be actually put in, become part of botnets. So what we're going to do next is we're going to talk about categories of devices, IoT devices, and kind of some of the unique vulnerabilities and threats that come from those particular categories.
So the first is kids and toys. Here we have a series of toys, a filleted Barbie. So when I was a grad student, and I'm saying this because I was not an FTC official at the time, so I can do this. I asked Jaku, who should be in this room because he told me he was coming, to hack a Barbie. He goes on local Chicago television news and will hack things, and I was like, please hack a Barbie. Like, something about Hello Barbie really bugs me. Because children have intimate conversations with their dolls, and they tell things to their dolls that they don't necessarily tell to anyone else. And who has that information? How is it being collected? And Hello Barbie really was one of the first popular ones to come out on the market. So it's really not anything against Barbie itself or Mattel, but generally. And so then Jaku bought his first Barbie, and he was very excited, and he hacked it. And the ecosystem is better because security researchers like you guys will hack things that necessarily you aren't the customer, but somebody else is who isn't necessarily one who can do that type of research. So thank you for doing that and like spending the time to, you know, hack devices and report vulnerabilities, because that's one of the most important parts of this process.
And there's currently, if you haven't heard, a DMCA security exception that allows for investigating home-related, consumer-related IoT devices. So we're not your lawyers. Look at the guidance, but there is a DMCA security exception that at least kind of protects you from that legal recourse from a company if they want to go after security researchers.
So common vulnerabilities you'll see in toy products, and a lot of this is based on research done by awesome security researchers. But you know, something that's special to children's toys includes unauthorized tracking and data collection, right? If we don't know what's happening to the information collected about children, there's a specific law that the FTC regulates, the Child Online Privacy Protection Act, that governs kind of what kind of information can be collected about children. And there has to be parental consent when information is collected. And so because of that, toys have this unique responsibility to kind of make sure that they know what they're collecting. And the next one is locks. I'm not a fan of smart locks. It doesn't seem like a good idea to me. But here they have an implicit claim for security, right? You don't buy a lock because you don't want to be secure. Like you just, that doesn't make sense. But here, physical security of the lock, if it's made of plastic, that's a concern. You can, you know, there are replay attacks. A lot of these locks have been found to just, you know, transmit the password in plain text. Or have too short of passwords or passcodes, and that's a problem. The next is cameras. You know, they're spying. A lot of what happened with Mirai, it was a lot of Chinese cameras. The thing is that, you know, there's very little incentive to, you know, build security around things where people are just going to install it and forget about it. And with cameras in particular, where, you know, there's some sort of installation, you have to think forward thinking about the update process, et cetera. It's a problem if we don't think about how consumers, in the end, will use the device. And that's going to, you know, play into our talk a little bit later, too.
So here's a quick good place to talk about what the FTC does. So the FTC has an act that says that we can bring cases against companies that conduct unfair or deceptive practices. So what that essentially means is if a company makes a promise to a consumer and doesn't actually fall through with that promise, then the FTC has authority to bring a case against them. Unfairness essentially means that if there's an act that is not reasonable, then we can bring an act a case against that company for that particular unfair business practice. So in the context of IoT devices, there's been a few cases that the FTC has brought. TrendNet was the first one. This was essentially IP cameras, baby monitors, where TrendNet had several misrepresentations to consumers. Essentially the live feeds for these cameras, these baby monitors, was available online for anyone to see. There's a reason why I don't have a baby monitor. Their specific misrepresentations were about security consumers and over the ability that consumers could actually control the settings on the device itself when it wasn't actually the case. Also, there was just an unfairness count saying it was unfair to consumers because of their failure to prevent unauthorized access to the live feeds.
A few other cases that we've brought against IoT, or the FTC, not we in particular, have brought against the IoT companies. First one is Asus. This came out in August 2016. But basically, there were a series of misrepresentations about the security of the cloud service they were offering, as well as the router in itself. It was found that they were not patching vulnerabilities. Their update tool actually was not properly providing updates to, so even if you were one of the few consumers who updates the router, it wasn't updating properly and having the newest patch. And ultimately, it led to a settlement. And then D-Link was filed two weeks ago, and it alleges misrepresentations of security and also mentions hard code passwords. The next are appliances. I have an obsession with this egg minder because I have decided I just don't understand why this exists. Nothing against the company, but it's all over the internet, this egg minder, but there's an expiration date on your eggs, and that to me seems like it's good enough. But anyways, there are all sorts of devices. There's another one here. This is the wireless whiskers. I have a cat. I'd love to know that I could, like, feed him remotely. That would be great, but I'd also be really scared that, you know, if dying happens and the device fails to, like, feed my cat, that could be really bad. So, you know, there are pros and cons to all sorts of appliances, and what, like, why. And, you know, for the necessary South Park reference, I guess you can not worry that anything's going to happen to your eggs. And finally, with appliances, there's this unique concept of physical harm. You have that in the health devices, but that's, you know, makes sense. But here, you know, you're trying to make some food, there's a fire. In the end, you're like, so I went back too far. Oh, well. Anyways, you know, all you wanted to do was make some toast and your appliance exploded. So if security's not taken proper, you know, seriously in appliances, there can actually be physical harm.
So, but how do you update these devices? I mean, some of them don't have, screens. How do you update a car? How do you update this little, what is this rotating thing? It's an open question, and the FTC actually announced a challenge around security updates, so I encourage everyone to apply if you're interested.
Consumers are basically help. Like, I don't understand, I don't think about updating my blender because you were trained, right, to purchase an item and then it's good until it breaks. And even in the past 20 years, most consumer products, right, the repair industry has died, right? Like, no one gets their television repaired anymore. They just go and buy a new one. So the idea of, you know, conditioning consumers to update things, you know, is a problem in itself. We're going to speed through because I realize we have a lot to go through and we are not getting to the meat of our talk. So health and sensors, there's, you know, connected toothbrushes, and we're wondering, you know, is this going to provide information to your dentist, and, like, are your insurance rates going to go up if you're not using your electric connected toothbrush. There's even now a Bluetooth connected tampons, which I, you know, the reality is like I could see that somewhat being helpful. I know most of you in this room cannot relate to that, but but at the same time, really, like really. And then finally, there's a Bluetooth connected onesie for your child. And at DEF CON, researchers even discussed the connected vibrator that was actually sending live when it was being used for back to the company for marketing purposes. And if you haven't seen that talk, it's up online. It's worth watching. It's very interesting. But worth mentioning, right? Like they're sending information about your use of a product back. And so we need to, you know, say stop. That as well. There are lots of good IoT Twitter accounts. So we're going to mention our disclaimer again for those who weren't here in the beginning of our presentation. These are our views. All of the products we've mentioned are not necessarily I've not looked at them. I've never owned them. So we're just mentioning them out of the fun, just for fun. So.
Okay, the meat of our presentation. So, Goodnight, bad IoT. What have regulators done? So, one thing to keep in mind is government as a whole is not government. There are lots of parts of the government. So, here is a very non-UX right pie of all of the people that have talked about or released some sort of guidance or documents around IoT security. And I imagine that as we go on, there will be many, many more. The white one is the NSTAC. So as a kind of a timeline, you have a bunch of different things coming out, but really the bulk of the guidance that's come out from the US government at least has been really actually in 2016. So we're gonna go through kind of most of these documents and kind of give high level summaries of them and highlight things that are different from them or things that are kind of consistent across the guidances. So this will be a quick, So DHS in November released their strategic principles for securing the IoT. They have 6 principles. Each principle has suggested practices that go into greater depth. I'm not gonna read the principles, but some of the suggested practices are kind of your basic security parts that are pretty, at least in my view, straightforward. Enable security by default, design with system and operation disruption in mind, like we talked about, failure modes, secure devices over network connections, coordinate updates among third-party vendors, so on and so forth, including advise consumers on the intended purpose of the IoT device, which I'm not sure what that does for security, but it's in the strategic principles as a suggested practice. What DHS says going forward they would like to see happen is public-private partnerships and identifying and advancing incentives for incorporating IoT security. I think thinking about incentives is a great idea, but there's not hardly any meat to that discussion, which I think I think us as a community could help kind of push that discussion along.
It's also worth noting, everything we're talking about is that just that, guidance. You will see that it's a lot of information. Not everyone's using the same terms, and no sticks, right? The reality is what's the incentive of a Chinese camera manufacturer to actually follow any of this guidance? And so here, you know, that's kind of the theme and the takeaway right now is, you know, we can talk about it a lot, but really, if you're not doing anything to like actively regulate it, it's just that, a lot of talk.
Yep. So here's another venue that's potentially a lot of talk. I know Alan Freeman's in the audience.
Sorry, Alan.
Sorry. this is convening multi-stakeholder processes of industry folks to come together and come up with some sort of set of principles or discussions on upgradability and patching. That's a new process that just started. But again, not a lot of meat to the discussion, just a lot of talk at this point. One of the very first IoT-specific reports was from the NSTAC, which is an advisory committee, and they said, well, if IoT devices will continue to grow and security will continue to be an issue, and this is what various parts of the government should do. One of them was having an interagency task force. Another was having NIST come up with a definition for IoT. A few years down the road, NIST came out with a document that talks about somewhat of a definition called the Network of Things.
Yeah, so they asked them to define the Internet of Things, and NIST was like, oh, hold up. There's also this thing called the Network of Things, and they make the distinction between the Internet of Things and the Network of Things. I don't know. Has anyone in this room ever used the term Network of Things? Yeah, okay. So like in 2016, when everyone's using IoT, NIST is like, oh, we're going to use Network of Things. But they basically say, you know, there are the devices connected to the broader internet. That's the Internet of Things. But it's technically inaccurate to call devices that are in smaller local area networks, you know, Internet of Things. They're really Network of Things because they're on a network and they're connected but not connected to the internet. And it's like, that's fair, but... that makes making that distinction can come bite you in the butt later when someone's like, oh, well, this regulation should only apply to Network of Things but not to Internet of Things, but then an update makes it an Internet of Things. So, you know, there could be issues down the line with this. Oh, and they mentioned, like, primitives, like, what is a network of thing? And it has a sensor, an aggregator, a communication channel, an external utility, and a decision trigger. They explain what those are because just by their names, they're not very, it's not very clear what, like, a decision trigger is. Mm-hmm. But I think that's, like, you know, consumer makes a choice.
So one of the first documents that has a lot of meat on it is the FTC's IoT staff report, which came out in January 2015, which predates the time that we started at the FTC. And this essentially was a staff guidance document, and it said it warned back in early 2015 about the risk of DDoS attacks from insecure IoT devices that we saw. And it goes through a lot of kind of staff guidance, like you should implement security by design and smart defaults and test devices before you release them and patch devices and have appropriate...
Common sense,
yes. So tied to that was another kind of pamphlet that goes into greater depth, something, you know, a lot better in terms of depth, one of the more deeper government guidance documents that we've seen, things like check for possible cross-site scripting or CSRF vulnerabilities, do salting when necessary, rate limit your APIs if appropriate, and consider running a bug bounty program.
And the reality is, you know, companies, when they're just trying to get a product to be purchased, right, you're not thinking, oh, I need to think about what if my product doesn't make it. Like, how do I end the life of the product? I get that that's like a hard choice. It's like, you know, buying a tombstone. You don't want to do it, but you know eventually sometime this, you know, you're not going to last forever. But it's something, you know, we encourage people to really think about.
So just last month, the FDA released their final version of their post-market management of cybersecurity and medical devices. For those reading the slides later, no...
We are not
reading it all. But one of the things that was unique about this, you know, the FDA is unique because medical devices can kill you. But they emphasize threat modeling repeatedly throughout this non-binding guidance, and that's something that's been different than the other documentation that we saw from the government. One of the sticks in the medical device space is, can the medical device manufacturers actually update devices for security flaws on the fly? FDA has a very rigorous process for a medical device to go to market. And the question is, you know, does a minor security update actually require them to go through this really long and stringent testing before going back out to the market? And the FDA said, no, for routine updates of cybersecurity patches that don't substantially change the design, then it doesn't need it. So the FDA is really emphasizing that if you bring a medical device out to market, you should patch, and you should patch quickly. And that is an important contribution to the medical device industry, and there's been a lot of movement by the FDA, I think a lot, and thanks to the community here for that.
So we're also going to talk about a handful of documents that aren't necessarily IoT specific, but have been talked about in the IoT world. Most of them are NIST related. And so 800-160 is system security engineering. The basic idea here is like not too much complexity. They really want system security engineering to, you know, be part of the life cycle, you know, to build in security.
So the emphasis here is we don't want to bolt security controls on top of systems. We want to actually have processes in place that as you build a system, you design it securely.
I also don't know what cyber hygiene is, but...
it's brushing your teeth.
Yeah. So, but they do emphasize that cyber hygiene, everyone drink, is really not enough.
So NIST cybersecurity framework that came out in early 2014 has actually been kind of one of the bigger efforts by government and industry and academia to have a set of subcategories that talk about security for originally critical infrastructure, but it's being talked about in other areas. But the thing to mention here is that a lot of the IoT device or the IoT security guidance that's come out from other agencies has actually gone back and referenced the NIST cybersecurity framework. The FDA in their post-market guidance that I just mentioned goes back and kind of outlines parts of the cybersecurity framework that are important specifically for medical devices. You know, this is a document that's a lot of people have kind of drifted to, and they're NIST is continuing to update it. So the latest update talks about supply chain management issues.
And really briefly, we're going to mention state laws. There may be others, but this one is worth noting. California actually has a state law against smart televisions or regulating smart televisions. This came out. This law was passed right after the Samsung privacy policy spying debacle that happened on, like, that was popular in the news. And basically, in response, they created this law that regulates, you have to notify the consumer of when they're doing voice recognition technology. You can't sell or use that speech captured for marketing purposes. And no government coercion to add voice features, which I thought was really interesting. Here's the thing. Now there are Alexas and Amazon Echo and all of these different devices that basically do the same thing but aren't a television, and this law doesn't regulate that. So it would have been great if it were a broader law, but this one, like, laws are very reactionary sometimes, and this one is very specific. And because of that, you know, it missed a lot of other potential opportunities to, you know, regulate devices that haven't even come out yet.
So this is kind of the a list of non-government guidance that has come out. Most of the time, this guidance is actually more detailed, more particular, addresses specific risks that come up in IoT devices. And so we wanted to highlight OWASP's top 10 IoT vulnerabilities. Some of these are actually the same as the regular top 10 in a lot of cases. And so as we kind of look at and categorize devices, I think we can also look more particular at risks that are particular to IoT devices. There is a IoT framework assessment by OWASP out too.
So it basically defines the IoT ecosystem and breaks it up into four parts. It's very, very long, but it gives specific examples as to what you should include in the cloud platform, you know, have a secure web interface, authentication, audit capability, et cetera. In the mobile side, you know, local storage security considerations, audit trail or strong audit trail of mobile interactions. And the thing is the list is very daunting. It's actually great because that's what a perfect device would look like. But the reality is, you know, new devices on the market aren't going to have the incentive to actually, you know, take these all into account unless there's an easy option for them to do so. So what are our takeaways? Well, first, there are a lot of players happening here. A lot of people are saying the same thing, but no one's actually doing anything really forward thinking with it. We can talk about having good security, but if there aren't laws and regulations to do it, there's no incentive for companies to do it. And the FTC has brought a handful of cases, and I imagine they will continue to bring cases against insecure IoT devices. But right now, it's kind of like, well, what are we going to do? And Aaron and I have talked at length about what the community can do specifically. One, if you haven't ever worked for the government, consider doing government service. I know it's a contentious time for some people, but the reality is we need smart technical people. Yes, the salary is lower than the private industry, but we need people doing good work. So please consider serving the government. The other idea is, creating open source free tools that developers can use to secure their devices so that they don't have to think about it. They can just build it right in. That's something that we could kind of create as a community and have available because... You know, the reality is what now? And so we have to move forward. Finally, something we've done, and I have not pushed this yet, but we are collecting all of the IoT guidance and documentation and putting it all in one spot so that people can look at what we were talking about, read about it specifically. We are going to try to keep this up to date as more information comes out in the future.
Please send us pull requests.
Yes, please send pull requests. If you know documents that we haven't mentioned, or if you see a document come across and we haven't updated it and you are using this, we would appreciate it, because at this point, in the future is going to hopefully create a law that is going to talk about security of devices. And when they're looking at like what all the guidance looks like, it'll be nice if it's all in one spot. And I think we have time for questions.
We do.
So thank you.
So since we have about 6.5-7 minutes, not just questions, we would love to hear and start a discussion about kind of approaches and ways that you think IoT can or shouldn't, or how it could be regulated. Yes, please.
Questions. Yep.
So with like the D-Link and the ASUS, how is that information getting related to the FTC? Is that just researchers, or how does that process work?
So that's a really great question. So the FTC brings cases just generally from various different resources. I've heard friends, will call up other friends, or they're the user of the product. But really, security researchers like you, you can send an email to the FTC and we will potentially look at it. And that's basically how we find out, in general about cases, is through the news, through friends, through resources. And so if you want to reach out to anyone in the FTC, whether it's research you're doing or you're curious what type of research we, are interested in, by all means.
So the address is either email us or research@ftc.gov. We're interested. We've publicly said in the past that, several cases that we've brought have come directly from research.
Yes.
Back one slide. Oh. Yep.
Sorry? Yeah, we'll put the slide deck up too.
Yes.
What about consumer safety advisors? Warning consumers of this equipment of the dangers of buying and using it?
Yeah. It's a area that I know less about. I don't know if Whitney does.
So the question was, what about consumer advisories or notifications? So the reality is, you know, you can disclose, hey, this is going to, you know, the FTC says frequently, and we believe as well, you know, notice and choice. Let the consumer know what's happening and let them make a choice. To some extent, that works. But in others, it doesn't, because you feel tied to a product or you've already purchased the product and you're getting a notice after the fact. So to some extent, it works and can be very helpful. And I encourage developers to, you know, provide clear information on their products about what they do and what they collect, because it shouldn't be buried in a privacy policy.
Yeah. And specific to safety, like exploding devices, there is a separate agency that deals with those types of safeties and safety recalls. I have not seen actually specific guidance from that agency, but I don't know that it's not out there, so we will look for that.
Yes.
So this may not work well because a lot of times the router manufacturers are part of the problem, but what about encouraging them to surface the information that is transmitting from networks so that consumers can see what is going out the door, so then they can start to identify those things that may not be behaving properly?
Question comment was why don't companies disclose what is exiting your home network via the device? What type of information is being sent back to the company? I think that notice and choice in large part means actually being clear to consumer what is actually being sent out. And I think that, you know, to date, it's required a lot of effort by the security community to, you know, reverse things, to find things out. And so companies being clear about what is being sent out, I think, would be a benefit to everyone.
I also generally have concern about consumer fatigue of choice. There is a benefit, right, of notifying somebody every time, you know, your device does something different. But people start ignoring warnings at a certain point. And so I know research is being done in this area, but, you know, on the softer side, you know, how many security warnings, how secure, you know, the reality is getting, you know, consumers to do 2FA is difficult. And, you know, doing the extra step to make a longer password. And so we need to think, you know, where's the balance so that it's not intimidating and it's not scary or it's not daunting so that they just give up and ignore it.
For the Revolve case, I'm wondering, do you conceive that there might be a scenario where if a company is going out of business, that it might be better to have them break their devices versus keeping a device that might have vulnerabilities in it?
So the question was, in a Revolve-like scenario, is there a scenario where if the company is going under, does it make more sense for the company to brick the device rather than letting it just persist with vulnerabilities or new vulnerabilities that are discovered later? I think that a lot of those questions come down to, you know, how, you know, what was your original promises that you made to the consumer in terms of supporting the device long term? You know, in Revolve, Revolve said that they're going to support the device for the lifetime of the, you know, for the lifetime. And so there has to be, if there is a bricking, probably a way for consumers to be made whole again from those promises. So like the closing letter in Revolve by the FTC says, you know, one part of closing the case instead of bringing it was that that they ultimately gave the full cost of the device back to the consumer. And so a bricking scenario might have to involve that.
I think we can do one more. Yep. So that's a really great question, and part of what, the question was, how do we incentivize, like, consumers aren't incentivized to update things when they don't see the problem affecting them, and I think that's, like, a really, really great point that I actually wanted to make earlier in the presentation, I forgot. But generally, right, consumers, if their camera is still working, what is the incentive for them to take it down, like either do a factory reset or update the firmware if they don't see the problem affecting them? And the reality is you have to keep that in mind when you design these products, either by auto updating without, you know, the consumer having to do anything, or designing a device, you know, deciding whether or not that device should really be connected to the internet, right? Like if you don't, oh, we are out of time, but generally that's it. But thank you all for coming.
Thank you.